Church, you're starting to wake up a little bit.
How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the dark,
then came the morning
that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave, it has no claim on me. Then came the grander earth has quaked before, moved by the sound of his voice. Seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken for my regard. And through it all, my far be it from me to not believe, even when my eyes can't see. And this mountain that's in front of me will be thrown into the midst of the sea. And through it all, through it all, it is well. So let go, my soul, and trust in him. The waves and wind still know his name. So let go, my soul, and trust in him. The waves and wind still through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you, and it is well. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my day.
I'm going to ask you a question, church. We just sang it. It is well with my soul. What does that mean to you? It is well with my soul. Or is it words we're just saying? Do you know what it means for it to be well with your soul? Things around us disappoint us. Prayers go unanswered. Struggles are real. And until we know our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, it can't be well in our soul. And when we know that, and when we know that God is working all things for good, it can be well. So if you're going through something today that you've prayed for and you've cried out, and your answer hasn't been answered, or the answer you wanted is not necessarily the answer you got. Because we believe in a big, true, wonderful, amazing Father God, it can be well. It can be well in your soul. Pray with me, church. Oh, good and gracious Heavenly Father, our living hope, the one who does what we see as impossible. Father, when we turn that over to you, you do the impossible. You work the miracles. Father, as sinful human beings, we try to hold on to it. We try to fix it ourselves because as grown, mature adults leading children in our world, we should have it all together. And we should know the answers, and we should know how to fix it. But Father, we live in a broken world, and we are sinners, and it is your desire that we turn to you for the fixing. We turn to you for the healing. We turn to you for the miracles. And so, Father, this morning, as we've just praised and worshiped you and called out to you, I ask that you touch our hearts and our minds for your desire, that we can turn over to you all those things that we may see as unanswered and sometimes get angry about, because your word says as you bring it to him in prayer, he will answer your prayer. Well, Father, sometimes we don't get the answer we want, and it's so easy for us to be angry instead of joyful. Father, turn our hearts to you, that every situation that we encounter in this life can be well in our soul if we turn it to you. And I pray, Father, that you are working here in this building right now, moving hearts and minds and souls, Father, to you. Be with us as we leave this holy place and go out into the world and put this hour behind us as something that we've done this week. Father, may it live in our daily walk so that we always know that it is well in our soul. And all God's people say, amen. Amen. Please have a seat. I'm a little out of breath this morning because I went back to get the microphone for announcements, and I came over here and I was worshiping, and I wasn't dancing or running around. I was just bopping, and I got out of breath. And I thought, we were blessed to go see Lauren Daigle this week. If any of you have seen her, that woman does not stop running for an entire 2 hours. She runs and sings and runs to her next song. And I remember thinking when we were there, I just wish I could run that long without singing. I guess we got to start walking this week, because I can't even bounce that long and then sing or talk. So it is good to be here with you this morning. For those of you who are regular worshipers with us, welcome back. For those of you who may be here for your first or second time, we welcome you. And for those who are worshiping online with us, we also welcome you here this morning. When you came in, you received a news and notes bulletin. In that, on the right side, far right side, there's a perforated section that you can tear out and turn into the ushers when they come forward today. You can put in your prayer requests. You can put in your praise reports. You can give us your email so that we know how to contact you. And you can accompany that with your tithes and your offerings, however the Lord leads you at the end of the announcements. A couple things we want to highlight this morning. I announced last week that we are starting a new junior high age group. We are pushing that again this week. If you in any way would like to help with that, even if it's once a month or however much it is, they are wanting to meet on Sunday mornings. I would like, Kim is in the back, where you take your kids to check in every Sunday morning. If you're interested in that during the mingling portion, she's kind of busy because she's checking children into children's worship. But after worship, I encourage you to see her or talk to Pastor Sam about how you would like to get involved in that. So please, if God is leading you to do that, but you don't know what kind of commitment that entails, I don't know either. But if you are interested in helping out with that, just please see Kim or Sam. Thirdly, we have a new small group. We have our small groups listed there under the study section. And we have a new small group, or a new group that's starting. It's a faith-filled women business leaders. And we're going to meet this Tuesday, 2 days, on the 18th here at 12:30. So if you would like to jump into that, you can see April Young. April is in the back over there. She'll be out front if you would like more information about that. Lastly, pizza with pastors. That's always hard, pastors. Instead of just Pastor Brad, it's pizza with Brad and Pastor Sam. What'd you say? It's so much easier. Pizza with pastors. That's good. Pastors. We encourage you to jump in to that. It's the first step in learning more about Living Word Church and becoming active here at Living Word Church. And that is April 21st. Is that today? No. Oh, this is March. What month are we in? Plus 7 days. So that's next Sunday. Next Sunday, the 21st, if you're interested in learning more about Living Word Church and how to become a member here or just how to get more involved, we encourage you to, you can put it here on the perforated tear out that you have, that you want to know more about that, or you will be attending, or you can call the church office, because they obviously at Pizza with Pastor Brad, and Pastor Sam, they serve pizza and salad. Yeah, so we want to make sure we have enough for each and every one of you. With that, we will ask the ushers to come forward to take up our tithes and our offerings, and we'll ask Pastor Brad to come forward. Children, come forward for your time with Pastor Brad. Thank you very much.
All right, this spring, we are experiencing the story of Jesus and his followers. You remember Jesus died on the cross and he rose from the grave, and then he empowered his followers to go and share his story. And we are part of that. And our wonderful key verse that we're going to learn today is from Acts chapter 16, because God empowered Paul to go out and share his story, and people responded. And you're going to learn all about the jailer at Philippi and all the people who responded to that story in Acts chapter 16, verse 30. He then brought them out and asked, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And they replied, "Believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household." So what was so cool is they had a miracle happen where there was an earthquake and all the soldiers were able to deal with the situation in a way that brought them to faith. The prisoners, which Paul was one of them, they were in the jail cells, and all of a sudden the doors opened up. And for me, that's a great picture of faith. It's like a door opens up in your heart and your soul. Normally, what do you use to open up a door? So you know about a key? Have you all seen one of these? What do you do with this? You unlock a door, right, and it opens. And this is the master key to the church, and it unlocks every single door in this entire place. That's pretty cool, right? But look at this. Does anybody guess what that is? It's a key fob. Do you know what a key fob is? Anybody? No? Do you ever walk up to your parents' car and the door just unlocks? Yeah. Whoa! Miracle! Oh my goodness, how'd that happen? I bet they have a key fob. This key fob is for the church. And if you wave it in front of the keypad, whoa! The door opens. You don't have to stick a key in there. It's a key fob. Isn't that kind of cool? Have you ever seen that work where someone has a fob? You will when you're in college, because all the college dorm rooms and apartments have fobs now. That's a lot like faith. You don't see it, but it unlocks something. When you believe, when you turn and trust in Jesus, he unlocks something wonderful in your heart. He gives you the ability to trust him, and that gives him the ability to forgive your sins and give you a relationship with God that lasts all the way through death and into eternity. And so I want you to think about that when you hear the story of the jailer at Philippi and all the people who say, "What must I do to believe?" And it's just simple. What saves us? Faith. Like a fob. Faith fobs. You've got one, I hope. With that, go to your age-appropriate learning experience. Miss Kim, raise your hand. Parents, if you haven't checked in yet, now's your time. And then let's have the adults and youth greet one another and welcome each other here to worship.
Jesus' followers continued to spread the word about him, including Saul, now called Paul, and his friend Barnabas. They traveled by foot and boat, inviting other followers of Jesus to join them in sharing the good news about Jesus. In each new city they visited, Paul would go first to the synagogue to share with the Jewish people that the Messiah had come. Everywhere he went, people believed what Paul was teaching and chose to start following the way of Jesus. But some simply couldn't believe what Paul was saying, and others were threatened by Paul's message and began trying to find ways to stop him. A few times, Paul and his friends were attacked and beaten so severely that they almost died. They were also thrown in jail. Despite this opposition, Paul kept telling others about Jesus. One night, sitting in prison, Paul and his fellow worker Silas began to sing songs to God in the middle of the night. When they did, a violent earthquake shook the jail and all of the prison doors came open. The prison guard was so distraught that he took out his own sword to kill himself until Paul shouted out, "Don't harm yourself. We are all here." The guard was so overwhelmed by Paul and Silas that he asked them to tell him and his family about Jesus and about God's ways. In each city, Paul helped Jesus' followers organize themselves into communities called churches. After he left these churches, he would often write letters back to them to encourage, correct, and teach them to live more like Jesus. These letters were read aloud in the churches over and over and have continued to be read by followers of Jesus for thousands of years.
Don't you love the story? I do, because I don't know about you, but I like the Bible in this abridged version because it's the whole Bible from Genesis to Revelation in 31 lessons. So not everything that's in the Bible is in there, but the story of the Bible is. It's just powerful, and I'm glad that you're reading that. And as we now are going into the New Testament and the letters that Paul and other followers of Jesus wrote to the early church, I think it's great. Now, there's one book that I think those of us who are parents probably would never want to read. It's a short read. I don't know about you, but I like shorter reads for some reason. It's only 100 pages, but it's put out by the Attorney General, and it's called When Your Child Goes Missing, A Rescue Plan. And I hope none of you have ever had to or will ever have to read that short book. But it's interesting that it's basically a three-phase plan to rescue your children if they go missing. God had a three-phase plan to rescue his children who've gotten lost. And think about that. You know, we who are his children, God created everything. We are the ones who have wandered off. We are the ones who have gotten lost. We are the ones who are living in a broken world. And God knew that. And his first phase was to call forth a people by which he could bring a plan of salvation, the people of Israel, his chosen nation. And we've studied about that and about how even broken, imperfect people with great stories of adversity and challenges and of great faith, of turning and trusting in God, could bring forth his plan of salvation, which brings us to phase two. Phase two is Jesus. Israel in the flesh. One man who gave his life for many, rose from the dead, and delivered that plan of salvation for everyone who would believe. And the third phase of those of us who are lost and missing is the phase of the church that we're studying now. That God did through Jesus work salvation, and Jesus sent his Spirit to empower all those who have turned and trust in him to share that story and serve all the peoples of the earth in a way that they too can be rescued. That's the upper story of this lower story we're looking at. And so with that in mind, I want to give you a few points. First of all, we're going to look at how the power was to send, how the power is to share, and how the power is to serve. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Jesus said before he ascended into heaven, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the very ends of the earth." Right there, the giving of the power of the Holy Spirit to well up inside us for those of us who have turned and trust in him so that we can then share that with locally and globally. What I think is so powerful about that is we're going to see how that lives out. And if you need a good schooling in the Holy Spirit, then I suggest you go on YouTube or you go to Facebook and you Google Pastor Sam's sermon from last Sunday, because that was an amazing message of both information of the empowering of the Holy Spirit and then actually seeing the overflow of the Spirit through him in worship, and his message is just great. So please go. What do you think? I thought that was a great message. All right. So let's see how that's lived out in Acts chapter 13. Now, in the church in Antioch, so we're above Israel, one of the first outposts of a gathering of believers. They had spread the gospel through Judea and Samaria and were just now starting to reach beyond Israel. There were prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simeon, called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaen, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, that was King Herod, and Saul, who we learn becomes Paul. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them." So after they have fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off. The two of them sent on their way by the Holy Spirit, and they went down to Seleucia and sailed from there to Cyprus. The power of the Holy Spirit within us wells up, and that spreads through us. And that's one of the things that I think is significant here, that we have the power to send people forth with the story of Jesus so that more would hear. We at Living Word Church are doing that through our orchard. Our orchard is those who partner with us in spreading the gospel where we can't and where it needs to be. Whether that be here locally, like in the First Ward with Don and Jared Gibler, or to Africa with the White family, or to Indonesia with the Truett family, or wherever we're reaching people with the gospel, we partner with those who are part of our family who want to go to a place where we can together share the story of Jesus. It was interesting that, have you been to the grocery store? And thank you. I've been to Walmart. And you ever hear over the loudspeaker, attention customers, we have a lost parent who is looking for their child. If that's you, please come to the service counter. We actually had that happen at our community egg hunt, all of a sudden over the loudspeaker. We have a lost, and I'm like, oh my goodness, that's kind of fun. Not that we had lost, but we found everybody. And that's the plan, that whoever's lost is found. And that's the rescue mission that Jesus has us on. We have the power to send people out into that mission, and we have the power to share that mission. And when we do that, we learn why something happens. So we're going to go into the letters of Paul right now, two of them, because he had gone out and he had shared the good news and people turned and trusted in him and gathered up as spiritual family. And now he's writing back to the newborn spiritual families and saying, hey, I've got some good news for you. I've got the gospel for you. I also have some bad news for you because some of you aren't following the gospel. And he speaks to both. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, Paul, called to be an apostle by Christ Jesus, by the will of God, and our brother Sosthenes, to the church of God in Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus and called to be his holy people, together with all those everywhere who call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, their Lord and ours, grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Right there you have the template of the early church's email. You know, before emails, we couldn't quite understand how this all worked. They had a scroll, and when you'd unroll the scroll, you wouldn't have to roll it all the way out to see who wrote it at the end. That's how we used to do letters, right? And now in our emails, it says who's sending it, who's receiving it, and what the subject is. And I love the fact that Paul does this right here. Who he is, who's sending it, who's receiving it, and what the subject is. And it always is about grace. Sometimes he needs to remind people that they need to get back to grace. Galatians chapter 1, we have an example of that. Paul, an apostle, sent from men, not by men, but by Jesus and God the Father who raised him from the dead, and all the brothers and sisters with me to the churches in Galatia, grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins to rescue us, rescue, second phase of the plan, right? From this present evil age and according to the will of our Father, to whom be glory forever and ever, amen. And then here comes the not so good news. I am astonished that you are so quickly deserted, the one who called you to live in the grace of Christ, and are turning to a different gospel, which is really no gospel at all. Evidently, some people are throwing you into confusion and are trying to pervert the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one preached to you, let them be under God's curse. As we have already said, so now I say again, if anyone is preaching to you a gospel other than what you accepted, let them be under God's curse. For a pastor, this is challenging. For a person, it's like, you know, we need to always preach the simple gospel of Jesus, the rescue plan that God sends a people from whom a person came and saved the world to a people to share that story. And I love the fact that there are times when we're told we need to turn from what we're doing and trust in him. And we need to be able to do that so that by faith, the door's open. I know all of you are going to smirk when you go to your car and the car unlocks today. I know those of you who don't have a fob are going to be praying for a car that unlocks with a fob today. I understand that prayer. It took me years before that was answered. Paul wanted to make sure people, once they got that fob of faith, didn't try to start opening the door in another way and thinking it would work. It doesn't. But this church had started doing things, trying to earn their way back to God, and you can't. I don't know if you've tried or if you just started to try, but if you just started to try to earn your way to heaven, just stop. It don't work. How many of you have tried to earn your way to heaven? Raise your hand. A few of you. Does it work? No, it doesn't work. See, now those of you who've never tried to earn your way to heaven, you don't have to do that. You can live in God's grace and the freedom of the gospel and the fact your fob of faith works. Stay there with it. In Philippi, the kids are learning about a saving moment because they like stories and stuff. I'm trying to give you the undergirding so that when you jump in the car with them and they're just talking about slaves and chains and prison and all that, you know where they're coming from. Because you don't want to read that book put out by the government either, right? You know, how to visit your child in prison. Just kidding. What I love about the fact of that story is that Paul and Barnabas and all the prisoners are freed, not by any key, but by God himself. And then that jailer who was locked down by sin and trying to work his way to be appeased by the Romans was going to kill himself because he was trying to earn his way to heaven. And it didn't work. And he learned that the hard way. And he said, what do I got to do? You don't have to do anything. Just turn and trust. Believe. Have faith. And it works. And receive. And it's amazing that he did. And then he and his whole household were baptized. Powerful stuff. Which leads us to the power to serve. You know, the power to serve is when something really good happens. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. Paul, Silas, and Timothy to the church of the Thessalonians in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace and peace to you. What I love about this is now Paul, Silas, and Timothy. Timothy was converted on Cyprus. Do you remember when we just started this message that Paul and Barnabas were sent off to go to Cyprus and they converted Timothy, and now Timothy is following Jesus and he ends up being one of the new pastors of the whole movement for Christ, and Paul ends up writing him special books to be that one who has the power to serve and the power to share and the power to send forth even more into the harvest. And we always thank God for all of you and continually mention you in our prayers. We remember before our God and Father your work produced by faith, your labor prompted by love, and your endurance inspired by hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. Doesn't that just roll off the tongue? I love it when God's people are what? Working, produced by faith, laboring, prompted by love, and enduring, inspired by hope. That's how it's just, I just love that phrase. For we know, brothers and sisters, loved by God, there's grace, that he has chosen you, underlined chosen, because our gospel came to you not simply with words, but also with power, underlined words and power, with the Holy Spirit and deep conviction. You know how we lived among you for your sake, and you became imitators of us and the Lord, for you welcomed the message in the midst of severe suffering with the joy given by the Holy Spirit. And so you became a model to all the believers in Macedonia. And I don't know, how do I say that, Pastor Sam? I want to say Achaia, but that's something else, isn't it? Thank you, Achaia, very good. The Lord's message rang out from you not only in Macedonia, but Achaia. Your faith in God has become known everywhere. Therefore, we do not need to say anything about it, for they themselves report what kind of reception you gave us. And they tell how you turned to God from the idols to serve the living and true God and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescued us from the coming wrath. I love this. Why do I love this? I see God's ingenious rescue plan. It's about multiplication, not just addition. It's about God sharing faith with us to share faith with someone else who shares faith with someone else who shares faith with someone else. And the next thing you know, you have it all working together. Did you catch that? They were chosen, they were given God's word and the power of the Holy Spirit. They became imitators of those who gave them that word and modeled it for others. This is mentoring mission work right here, and it works. I heard a story about mass units in the Korean War, and it wasn't just about the TV show. That there were actually two helicopter mass units that were called up to deliver aid during one of the battles where people had been severely injured. One helicopter landed and just started treating people. And they were overwhelmed with the number of soldiers that needed their attention. So much so that they just couldn't keep up. The other helicopter lands. And they do what 1 Thessalonians did. They landed and set up a triage where people would come in, they would assess the medical need and then send them to the appropriate person to care for. And if they just had a superficial wound, they would bandage it and then ask them to help triage more soldiers coming in. They were able to multiply their efforts and be able to help all the soldiers who were coming at them with medical needs. What was the difference? Their rescue plan. It's simple, the rescue plan of God. It can be strategic, and we can be smart with it. You don't have to disciple the whole world. Did you know that? That's not on your shoulders. Yes, he said, go and make disciples. Go into the whole world. But your world is you, your household, your workplace, your community, right? And you are to go to one person and give them the fob that opens the door to heaven. And then that person can take that fob of faith and open another door. And then that person can take that fob of faith and open another door. We need to start sharing our story as parents and then grandparents and great-grandparents and great-great-grandparents. We don't need to parent the entire world. We need to parent the people God has placed in our life and teach them to parent the people God puts in their life and teach them and teach them. And that's how the church multiplies. What was our key verse for today? I loved it. Acts chapter 16. He then brought them out and asked, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And they replied, "Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved, you and your household." In my small group study this week, we were talking about the role of household as Christian business leaders, and that the biblical definition of household isn't just your immediate family. Do you know what household is in the Bible? It's your immediate family, your extended family, those who serve you, those you partner and work with are part of your family. And so we're talking as Christian business leaders. It's not just about making money, but it's also about those families and souls and people who work together to make that money. And how do we care for them? And they are part of the household. And how do we care for them spiritually? How do we encourage that? And that's what we're getting at here, you and your household. When the jailer at Philippi and his family was baptized, it wasn't just his children and his wife. It was his children, his wife, his co-workers in the prison guard, his neighbors, his whole household. And all of a sudden you have what? Church. That's empowered by the Spirit, given that wonderful gift of faith that works like a fob and opens up so many doors. God's plan is simple. When we believe, it's simple. We receive Him in a relationship with God the Father that lasts forever and brings forgiveness right now. That's pretty cool. When we who believe pray, and pray for power, it's something like the early church did when they gathered and we're given power, and that same power is available for us. As my good wife Cindy said, you know, if things are disappointing, keep on praying, because God is working His answer of yes, maybe no, and wait. But when He works His answer, it will be more miraculous than you could ever dream up. So we believe and we pray and we share and we serve. We share our story just like Paul did. Paul wasn't anything special except the fact he had faith that was empowered by the Holy Spirit and he shared his story. When you share your story, wonderful things will happen. When you pray, wonderful things will happen. When you believe, wonderful things will happen. And when you love, in acts of service, wonderful things will happen. You know, God stirred that early church up in Jerusalem that they reached Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. God is not done yet. And I believe we are part of His church, and He can stir us up, Living Word Church, so that we can reach our Jerusalem, our Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. We don't have to do it all. We do it one person and one household at a time. Then something wonderful is going to happen. So I'm going to challenge you. Are you ready for something wonderful? Well, let's do it. I'm going to invite the prayer team forward, the praise team forward, and as I'm doing that, I want to share you a story. So if none of this inspired you, this better. Or I hope it will. So we are a church that keeps it simple in God's Word, focused on the core of Christianity. We're open to how God works. And we have seen the power of the Holy Spirit work through His Word and work through His people here at Living Word Church. Pastor Sam referenced that last week. And the power of the Spirit overflowing into the lives of others is how He works miraculously. And just to put an exclamation point to the end of the worship last week, we had a member who came forward for prayer. And that member was having trouble with a torn rotator cuff and asked for prayer and was prayed over and anointed. And then as that person left the prayer team, do you know what she did? Hugged the person praying for her and didn't realize she'd been healed. Before that, she couldn't raise her hand. After that, she was hugging the person praying with her. She went to therapy this week, and her physical therapist says, I have not seen someone who's only been to two physical therapies with your severe injury being able to raise your hand like this. And she says, I raise it in praise to my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Does that happen every time? No. But it happens. It happens here. It happens when we who believe turn and trust in Him and pray, and then turn and trust and share our story and serve with love. Now, she can't go like this yet. I'm like, why do you have to go like that? Just go like this. We'll let her physical therapist work on that one, right? Pray with me. Lord God, Heavenly Father, as we laugh and chuckle, we're just overjoyed by the fact that your simple plan of rescue works. Your simple plan of rescue works. And sometimes you put an exclamation point on that and working some physical healing or relational healing or situational healing. And Lord, I just love the fact that we just simply believe and everything opens up. Maybe it's patience that opens up. Maybe it's perseverance that opens up until we see your miracle. Maybe it's love that opens up and a new attitude that opens up and a new way of doing life opens up, Lord, until we're in eternal life with you, Lord. But whatever opens up, Lord, I know each and every one of us needs something to open up now, today, this week. And we turn and trust and give it over to you, whatever's making us anxious in this moment. We kneel and bow and drop it at the foot of the cross. Because if you can carry the weight of our sins, you can carry whatever we're anxious about, Lord Jesus. In this moment, I pray for your word to come alive, your spirit to empower, and your miracles to be manifested. Why? Because we have the greatest story to tell, and it's our story, and it's your story. And if this is your prayer, please say amen. Amen. Amen.
Still you give kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
Lord, in acknowledgement of who you are, Jesus, being the God who wants to partner with us, Lord, in changing this world to look more like the kingdom of heaven. We thank you for that, Father. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
How are you, Living Word? Yes, you are truly blessed and highly favored. Do we have anybody celebrating a birthday today or this week? Raise your hand. This blessing's for you. This blessing's for you, Ella. This blessing's for you, those online. This blessing's for you. Do we have anybody celebrating a wedding anniversary today or this week? Raise your hands. Those raising their hands online, this blessing is for you. Do we have anybody starting anything new today? Raise your hands. This blessing is for you. This blessing is for you and for you and for you. And those of you who are new here for the first time, this blessing is for you. We have a little gift for you. Stop by the welcome home counter and we'll give that to you on your way out. Do we have anybody who's traveling this week? Raise your hand. This blessing is for you and 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 for you. And those of you online, be back here and fill these seats that these people are leaving for, so we have blessed worship for you. This blessing is for all of us. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the power and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.
Amen.
God bless your week.
Thank you so much for joining us in our worship experience today. I hope that the Holy Spirit really moved in your heart and soul as we worshiped Him and studied His Word. I'd love for you to connect more with Living Word Church, so go and visit our website, lwcba.org. Click on virtual worship. There you can check in and receive emails and the latest updates from our congregation. You can also turn in your prayer requests. Our prayer team is ready to pray with you personally right now and be happy to do that with you. You can also check out our small groups, our serve opportunities, and so much more. I look forward to worshiping with you next Sunday, and I pray that you just be blessed because you are highly favored.